Good morning. St. Anthony of Padua's parish family welcomes all who have gathered for our 25th Sunday of Ordinary Time. Before we begin our liturgy, you are kindly requested to turn off all electronic devices, including cell phones. Jesus speaks his own rejection, torture, and shameful death. True discipleship, he says, is concerned not with status, but with service to the poor, with justice and peace. This liturgy is being offered for the happy repose of the souls of Mr. and Mrs. Anthony Patti, Mr. and Mrs. Joseph Patti, and also for the people of the parish. Altar flowers are in loving memory of Thomas Gazzana. We begin our prayer by standing and joining in singing number 616, Praise to the Lord the Almighty, number 616.
Praise to the Lord the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise him, for he is your health and salvation. All you who hear, now to his temple draw near. Praise him in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord, who o'er all things is wondrously reigning. And as on wings of an eagle, uplifting, sustaining. Have you not seen all you have needed has been met by his gracious ordaining?
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Good morning. As we gather together as a parish family to celebrate the sacred mysteries of our faith, we pause for a moment, we call to mind our sins, and we ask the Lord's mercy and forgiveness. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You bring pardon and peace to sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You intercede for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who founded all the commands of your sacred law upon love of you and of our neighbor, grant that, by keeping your precepts, we may merit to attain eternal life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. The readings can be found at number 1165, number 1165.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The wicked say, "Let us beset the just one, because he is obnoxious to us. He sets himself against our doings, reproaches us for transgressions of the law, and charges us with violations of our training. Let us see whether his words be true. Let us find out what will happen to him. For if the just one be the Son of God, God will defend him and deliver him from the hand of his foes. With revilement and torture, let us put the just one to the test, that we may have proof of his gentleness and try his patience. Let us condemn him to a shameful death, for according to his own words, God will take care of him." The word of the Lord.
The words to the antiphon of the psalm are, "The Lord upholds my life." The Lord upholds my life. The Lord upholds my life. O God, by your name save me, and by your might defend my cause. O God, hear my prayer, hearken to the words of my mouth. The Lord upholds my life. For the haughty have risen up against me. The ruthless seek my life. They set not God before their eyes. The Lord upholds my life. Behold, God is my helper. The Lord sustains my life. Freely will I offer you sacrifice. I will praise your name, O Lord, for its goodness. The Lord upholds my life.
A reading from the letter of St. James. Beloved, where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder in every foul practice. But the wisdom from above is first of all pure, then peaceable, gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruits, without inconstancy or insincerity. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace for those who cultivate peace. Where do the wars And where do the conflicts among you come from? Is it not from your passions that make war within your members? You covet but do not possess. You kill and envy, but you cannot obtain. You fight and wage war. You do not possess because you do not ask. You ask but do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. God has called us through the gospel to possess the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
A
reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus and his disciples left from there and began a journey through Galilee. But he did not wish anyone to know about it. He was teaching his disciples and telling them, "The Son of Man is to be handed over to men, and they will kill him. And 3 days after his death, the Son of Man will rise." But they did not understand the saying, and they were afraid to question him. They came to Capernaum, and once inside the house, he began to ask them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they remained silent. They had been discussing among themselves on the way who was the greatest. Then he sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "If anyone wishes to be first, he shall be the last of all and the servant of all." Taking a child, he placed it in their midst, and putting his arms around it, he said to them, "Whoever receives one child such as this in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but the one who sent me." The Gospel of the Lord. Do you know the four Marian dogmas? The reason I'm telling you this is yesterday I was at a conference in Spanish for 5 hours on the Marian dogmas. It was awesome. I went there to practice my Spanish, but I learned a lot, not learned a lot, but refreshed a lot on the beautiful teachings. The first question would be, what is even a dogma? Well, within the church, there are different levels of teaching. There's what we would call discipline, which are teachings that can change. So for example, you know, if you recall prior to the Second Vatican Council, the Mass universally was in Latin. After the Second Vatican Council, they permitted the Mass to be celebrated in the vernacular or the language of the country. That would be a discipline, something that can change over time. Then there are doctrines. Doctrines are the constant teaching of the church, and we are called to believe them. Maybe they've been taught in a council, or they may have been taught the constant teaching, but they've never been formally declared. And then a dogma is basically a special announcement, a special declaration to say, this is the official understanding, and this is the teaching, and this is the authentic interpretation and meaning of this teaching. And so there's teachings about Mary. There's four principal dogmas in our Catholic faith. And everything we talk about Mary really is intended to help us understand more clearly who Jesus is. So it's not like singling out Mary and giving her
like extra honors. It's recognizing how pivotal a role she played in the Jesus's mission. So the four dogmas are, and I'm not going to give you a 5-hour course, I promise. Maybe 3.5 hours. The first dogma of, I'm going to go in order of her life, was the Immaculate Conception. The Immaculate Conception was a special grace given to Mary to prepare her to be the mother of God, mother of Jesus. And what we see here is that the teaching there is that through the merits of Jesus' passion and death, outside of time and space, prevented his mother from receiving the stain of original sin. So we say Mary was conceived without original sin. And what follows from that there also is that she never committed any type of personal sin either. It wasn't because she was a superhero. It was because she received a special grace from God, which she cooperated with to bring about the mission of her son. So the Immaculate Conception. The second teaching is known as the perpetual virginity, which means that Mary was a virgin before, after, and during the life of Jesus. What that is trying to show is that her whole life had a singular purpose of focusing on the life of her son, Jesus. It also accentuates the fact that Jesus, while both fully human and fully God, never had a biological father. And this gets into the mystery of the incarnation. The third dogma is the declaration. It's a Greek word called the Theotokos, the God-bearer. Mary is the mother of God. Not just the mother of Jesus. Yes, she is the mother of Jesus. But we can say she is the mother of God because Jesus is fully God and fully man. And since Mary is the mother of Jesus and Jesus is God, we give that title, Mary, as the mother of God. It's not saying Mary's better than God or higher than God. Mary's a human being like you and I, given a special grace to carry out the mission of Jesus. And then the fourth dogma is the assumption of Mary into heaven, body and soul. When we die, our bodies and souls separate, and we bury the body, or perhaps you get cremated and put the cremains in the ground. We await the resurrection of the body at the end of time. Mary had a singular privilege to be assumed into heaven, body and soul, just like her son Jesus had rose from the dead, body and soul. She has a glorified body. Now, these teachings are beautiful, and what they do is they give a clarity to understand. But we sometimes can be like the disciples and say, I don't understand what he's talking about. And we are afraid to ask a question, so we dismiss it. And that's the connection I want to kind of bring to the gospel. We have a special gift in our Catholic faith, which sometimes we forget or we don't really think about. We believe that Jesus has given the church a special charism to authentically interpret the scriptures, the scripture and tradition, so that we can have a certainty on the teachings of Jesus. And so just to give you those examples, those four dogmas are really gifts that come from God to give clarity on the life of Mary and her role in the life of Jesus. And so we can look to the church for an understanding to guide us in our path through life. Which brings me to the gospel. If you notice Jesus, this is the second time it happened, last week too. Jesus is trying to teach his disciples about what we call now the Paschal mystery. He's going to be arrested, he's going to be put to death, and 3 days later, he's going to rise from the dead. And so Jesus is trying to explain that to his followers. And if you recall, last week, Peter's like, Lord, no, I don't think you should do it this way. I think you should avoid the suffering. And then remember, Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. That was last week. In other words, Peter was trying to tell God, I don't agree the way your plan. I think you should do it that way. I think you should do it my way. Now, no one in here has ever said that to God, correct? What I'm trying to say is what Peter did, we fall into the trap of his also. And today's gospel, we see Jesus again at a little bit later time trying to explain to his followers, hey, I'm going to be arrested and put to death. And 3 days later, I'm going to rise from the dead. And the scriptures say, They didn't understand his saying, and they were afraid to question him. So you get a picture of Jesus like sharing this intimate point about his life, and then, hey, Peter, by the way, I want you to know I'm greater than you. And John saying, oh, yeah, well, I'm better than you. And we have this discussion about who's the greatest. What's happening now is they're not listening to Jesus. They're focused on their own desires, their own whims, their own ways of comparing. No one here has ever compared themselves to someone else, correct? No one has ever battled for who's the greatest. I want to be recognized. I want to do all this so that people notice me. The reason I'm saying this is that what we read in the gospel, it's not just something that they do. It's kind of in showing for us, we can fall into those same traps. We can fall into, perhaps I say it this way, a worldly understanding of what it means to be the greatest. And here's what Jesus does. He surprises them, and he says, if you want to be the greatest, if anyone wishes to be first, he shall be the last of all and the servant of all. That's counterintuitive. That's kind of an oxymoron. If you want to be first, I want you to be last and be the servant of all. Then what he does is he takes a child now and puts it in his midst, and he says, whoever receives this child receives me. Now, that kind of might sound nice and sentimental in this day and age, but you have to understand at the time of Jesus, a child was a nobody, had no rights. It was insignificant. And so it would be easy to ignore. You know that story when you heard it hundreds of years ago. Children are not to be spoken. Children are not to speak. They're supposed to be until they're spoken to. You know that phrase, what I'm talking about? Like they used to talk about that. But my point is that children had no rights back then, no real dignity. And Jesus then is saying, look, guys, if you want to be number one in my book, if you want to be first, accept this child. Be like this child. There's something also to a child too. And it gets lost. But there's something in a phase of a child where there is an innocence. There's a willingness to trust, a humility, a confidence that their parents are going to provide for them. Unfortunately, as we grow, we kind of lose that. And then all of a sudden, those teenage years, let me tell you, mom and dad, how you should do this. You're laughing. You know what I'm talking about. And then hopefully we can grow through that, and then there's a maturity. I think when Jesus is calling us to look at a child, he's calling us to reflect on, do we have that humility? Do we have that ability to accept and to trust that God will provide for us? That God gives us his teaching to help us navigate? And my own reflection in my own life, but perhaps you can relate to this, is that sometimes I feel like I want to be like that little child and trust, but often I find myself as that rebellious adolescent. Don't tell me what to do. I'm going to do it my way. It always gets me in trouble. And so as I'm listening to the gospel today, I'm sensing the Lord say to me, but perhaps to us as well, all of us, hey, be like this little child. Not childish, not immature, but trusting and believing and humble. And to be a disciple of mine is to be a servant. In other words, to not look at just what I want and what my needs are and how I want things, but to grow in a deeper appreciation to see the needs of the other. How can I help another in the family? How's my spouse doing? How are my children doing? At school, sometimes maybe looking out and seeing a child or a kid that's not accepted or part of the group, and it's easy to forget that person. What could I do to help that kid or to include that child? These are all little simple ways that we can do that. And today, as we enter into this Mass, let's pray for that grace. Lord, help us to be childlike. Help us to be trusting, humble, and not seek for honors, not to go out of our way to be recognized, but to love you, Lord, and to do that in a hiddenness, in a way that's you see, but we don't have to show off to other people. So to follow Jesus, to listen to Jesus is not always easy. We want to embrace his teachings. We want to follow him. But we have to recognize, as we heard in the second reading, there's a battle inside our hearts. There's a conflict. And the only thing that really can really bring that conflict to a peace is a regular prayer life and the grace of God's sacraments. None of us is going to have the same role as Mary. But Mary did incredible things because the grace of God operated in her. She was open to that completely. All of us can look to Mary as our model, as our spiritual mother, to help us cooperate with the supernatural power we call grace in our own lives, so that we can be faithful followers of Jesus.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. He rose again the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead. Trusting in the Lord, we bring him our needs, the needs of our community, and the needs of the whole world.
That the church may continue to spread the message of hope to every corner of the world, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That national and local leaders may seek the counsel of the Holy Spirit as they make their decisions for the common good, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who minister in the church may be blessed with the wisdom to lead God's people to the kingdom of heaven, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For catechists, may they be blessed with creativity and enthusiasm as stewards of God's gifts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have fallen away from the practice of their faith may seek the help of the Holy Spirit to be renewed and live their faith more fully. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of our parishes and all families, that our merciful Father may continue to bless us, keep us, and help us to grow together in love and faith. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Christians will work together to assist those who are poor, needy, and ill, and that they may be encouraged by our prayers, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially Mr. and Mrs. Anthony Patti, Mr. and Mrs. Joseph Patti, and our recently deceased Gloria June Longenbach, that they may share fully in the joys of the saints in heaven, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the intentions we hold close to our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty Father, enable us to be more responsive to your word and lead our lives in ways which give you praise and glory. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. As we offer our gifts to the Father, we join in singing number 751, the Servant Song, number 751.
me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. We are pilgrims on a journey. We are travelers on the road. We are here to help each other walk the mile and bear the load. I will hold the Christ light for you in the night time of your fear. I will hold my hand out to you, speak the peace you long to hear. I will weep when you are weeping, when you laugh, I'll laugh with you. I will share your joy and sorrow till we've seen this journey through.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all his holy church.
Receive with favor, O Lord, we pray, the offerings of your people, that what they profess with devotion and faith may be theirs through these heavenly mysteries. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty, our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation through Christ our Lord. Through him, the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Indeed, holy and to be glorified, O God, who love the human race and who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst when we are gathered by his love. And when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come, until you come again.
Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross, to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us, and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. Bring your church, O Lord, to perfect faith and charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Alfred, our Bishop, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, and the entire people you have made your own. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters. Inspire in us words and actions to comfort those who labor and are burdened. Make us serve them truly after the example of Christ and at his command. And may your church stand as a living witness to truth and freedom, to peace and justice, that all people may be raised up to a new hope. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, there in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and martyrs, with Saint Anthony, and with all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, 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 amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church," and graciously grants her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
as we come forward to receive Jesus, we join in singing number 932, One Bread, One Body. Number 932. Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more. One bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord. Many the gifts, many the works, one in the body,
one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord.
Let us pray. Graciously raise up, O Lord, those you renew with this sacrament, that we may come to possess your redemption, both in mystery and in the manner of our life, through Christ our Lord. As you know, the month of October is the month of the rosary, so I just wanted to, I wrote a little bit about it in the bulletin, but I'd like to have a rosary challenge with our parishes. So Our Lady Mercy, St. Anthony, our Hispanic community, to during the month of October to pray a rosary every day. Now, if you pray the rosary every day, I'm going to challenge you to pray all sets of the mysteries if you want, joyful, sorrowful, glorious, luminous. If you don't pray the rosary, if you've never prayed the rosary, we'll have some materials there to try to practice a decade a day. But we want to kind of unite our families in prayer and with the intention of the spiritual protection and the spiritual renewal of our faith in the Lord and in our parishes. So I just wanted to plant that seed, and there'll be more information to come. But get ready, get your fingers loose, okay? Have a wonderful week. The Lord be with you.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Go in the peace of Christ, glorifying the Lord by your life. Thanks be to God. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. Do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl throughout the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
Next Saturday, September 28th, at 1 p.m., the Holy Name will host a men's retreat and cigar social. Tickets are $30. For more information, please see the bulletin. After summer break, Coffee and the Word will be starting again. This Tuesday morning at 8:30 a.m. and every Tuesday morning thereafter following the 8 a.m. Mass, we will meet in the gathering place at the St. Anthony's Parish Center. As in the past, we will be focused on the Word of God in the liturgy as well as in study on topics relevant to the world today. Remember, it's BYOB, bring your own Bible. Next weekend, there will be a second collection for the Special Church Repair Fund. If you would like your donation recorded, there are envelopes available in the pews. Renewed in faith, we go forth singing number 829, Let There Be Peace on Earth. Number 829, we will be singing the alternate words.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be with God, our Creator. Family, all are we. Let us walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow, to take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on